What are the coolest psychology tricks that you know or have used? If you have trouble motivating yourself to do something like learn a skill, instrument, language, etc., tell yourself, okay, I'll sit down and do this for just 5 minutes. A lot of the time, you'll end up going for much longer than 5 minutes. But even if you don't, it's still 5 minutes of practice and whatever the heck you wanted to learn in the first place. If someone won't stop talking or let you get a word in, drop something. Keys, pen, reach down to pick them up and start talking. It's a way to interrupt without the other person realizing it. When something funny happens and people or a person in a group laughs, they will look at the person they like or care about in the group the most to see if they're laughing too. When you notice this, it's quite easy to tell who likes who. When you're talking to someone who's being defensive and there is a pause in the conversation, let them fill it. If you want to calm someone down, sympathize with them whilst describing what's upsetting them in descending orders of magnitude. I understand why you're angry. You're right to be frustrated. This would annoy me too. As they accept the acknowledgements they want, they should also accept the declining emphasis on emotion and become calmer. Giving students in my elementary class the illusion of choice. If you ask, "Do you want to start your work?" or "Isn't it time we get something done?" I modify it to, "Would you like to do your assignment with a pencil or blue pen?" They are too consumed with this choice that they have forgotten that they didn't want to do it in the first place. Also, every recess, "Did you push Jimmy?" "No." "Okay, two people saw you do it and reported it to me. Are you sure you didn't?" "I'm sure." Then change it to, "Can you tell me why you pushed him?" "Well, it's because..." Gets him every time. The flinch. Whenever you're negotiating a raise, the sale price of a car you want to buy, who does what chores around the house, always flinch visibly at the first and sometimes second offers. The flinch can be as simple as a small wince, a sigh, or an eye roll. The flinch quite often causes people to lowball the initial offer. I learned this from my was-husband, and it freaking works. Got my current job at 10% over the max salary because I flinched. When you need someone to wait a moment as you hunt for something, or you're struggling, say, "Thank you for your patience," instead of, "Sorry for the wait." It subtly strokes their ego and makes them more likely to be kind and patient with you, because you've already asserted that they're kind and patient people, and denying that would hurt their own self-image. Works with most people, but some are just raging assholes, lol. If someone is talking or preoccupied, you can hold out your hand and they'll give you whatever they're holding. I did it to my sister with the car keys and made her think she lost them somewhere at the store. I had a very strange encounter with a coworker once. We were on a break, had chatted a bit, the usual mundane, "Are you married, etc., do you have kids?" And when I said no, she waited, staring at me for me to continue. Boy, did that ever work. The longer she stared, the more I babbled. I couldn't stop talking. I'd finish a sentence, she kept staring at me and I'd start talking again. And not because she was politely listening, she was compelling me to talk. I have no idea why she did that, if it was just her way or if she does that to learn things about people, but it was the creepiest conversation I ever had. I'm older now, so that wouldn't work on me, but it was sure effective at the time. The concept of getting something for free completely derails a person's critical thinking skills. My dad was a tool distributor and drove a truck to various repair shops selling tools to mechanics. He got an idea to start selling candy bars on his truck for $1. But you would get a free candy bar with every tool purchase. Almost everyone who asked how much the candy bar was didn't want to pay a dollar for one, but they would buy a $100 socket set in order to get the candy bar for free. The primary effect, you're more likely to remember the first item on a list, and the recency effect, you're more likely to remember the last item on a list. If I'm listing groceries for my husband, I make the most important items into bookends. If I'm talking to one of the parents of my students about their kid's behavior, I always list good, bad, good. They get the information about the bad, but what they remember about the conversation is how they felt good and saw that I care about their kid. My favorite is silently maintaining eye contact when a person is attempting to bargain or convince you of something that you don't want to do or don't believe. They usually end up negotiating with themselves, which gives you a huge advantage because once that happens, it's pretty much game over. Have a toddler that's in a bad mood? Sit down with them, look them straight in the eye, and say, "You're mad, so don't laugh." Just keep repeating it as seriously as you can. I've done it for 15 cousins over a couple decades, and by the fifth repetition of "don't laugh," they are busting a gut and rolling on the floor. I used the gray rock method on my narcissist brother-in-law. Basically, I made myself so dull and boring in the opposite of drama that he learned to avoid me at all costs. It worked like a charm, and only took 4 to 5 encounters to take effect. Many people, I would say most, maybe almost all, are surprisingly susceptible to flattery and being told what they want to hear. People tend to shy away from this strategy, thinking it will be too obvious and clumsy, but just try it. It's as if being flattered or hearing people agree with you gives people a rush of pleasurable hormones to the brain. Don't directly ask for money. When we do a program to ask fast food customers to donate a dollar, most people would say, "Would you like to donate a dollar to feed hungry kids?" Customers would almost always say no. If you said, "A dollar will feed a child for a day. If you'd like to donate, we can just add it to your ticket." Also in the archery store, people will ask what they owe for a quick repair. Most of them I tell, "Don't worry about it." they will usually tip $10 to $20 for a repair that we charge $3 to $5 for. If you work with clients, prevent them from getting defensive and angry by not using the word you. It's not you didn't send the attachment, it's the attachment didn't send. Don't blame them, blame the thing you're talking about. I take my time when I write emails to clients because I like to word things just right. One word can be the difference between a happy client and an unhappy one. The right words in the right order can influence people to make decisions you want them to make. Words are powerful. I prepare income taxes in the US. If I know I have a client coming to see me who is going to be upset, I will turn a nature sound station on Pandora and play it softly in my office. My client may be irate when they enter my office, but they always simmer down quickly once they take a seat. I'll take a minute or two to look up something so they have to sit there and listen. By the time they leave, they are always very happy and appreciative. People become what you call them. You treat someone like a monster, they become a monster. To ensure that someone maintains a certain positive trait, compliment them for it beforehand. People are more likely to follow you if they have your approval rather than trying to win it. You don't know how far people will go when they already have something to lose, a good impression they have on you. If you want someone to work hard for you, tell them how you admire their work ethic or how they seem like diligent employees based on their portfolio, resume, recommendations. If you want someone to be nice to your friends, tell them they have a kind face. Don't say this to a guy if you're a guy, or say that you heard a lot of good things about them. Words are immensely powerful. This is also why I never call someone any bad names, even if they deserve it. Best one for kids, and this works wonders for behavioral problems. You never say, don't do X. I had a terror child in daycare and people would yell at him for acting out. I would start each day by saying, you're going to be a good boy today. And every time he acted out, I would say, wait, you're my good boy, right? He would say yes and stop doing it. When his mom came to get him, I made a point of telling her how good he was. The child never acted out around me after a week. The basic idea is to ask your opponent questions when you are arguing with them. Whereas normally you'd be building points to support your own argument or looking for flaws in their points, you can instead force them to start tearing it down themselves. People usually place more value on an opinion if they came to it on their own rather than if someone else tried to convince them of it. It's a natural bias. I came to this conclusion myself, so I know it makes sense to my brain. If you ask them questions, this forces them to test their ideas on their own and see if they hold up. This is especially easy because even in regular conversation, asking questions is just a generally good tactic to maintaining flow. I'm a good listener, and folks usually think of listeners as people who aren't as strong at influencing others. But you'd be surprised how well you can convince people by just letting them discover their own fallacies and then being prepared with an alternative viewpoint. You want someone you just met to like you? Ask them open-ended questions about themselves. Don't wait for your turn to speak. Listen, and then ask a follow-up question based on what they said. If you do that a couple times, that person feels heard and appreciated by you. If they realize they're doing all the talking, they'll apologize and ask a question of you. If your answer is short and pivots back into something they said, you have now formed a connection in their mind as a good listener who is interested in what they have to say. People like that a lot. I learned this from my primary school principal. When you're angry, raise your voice. When you're really angry, lower it. You can end a lot of arguments with a simple, I understand what you're saying. It validates them while you maintain your position. Kids do well with forced decisions. Don't say, go brush your teeth. Say, you can brush your teeth before or after a story. It gives them the impression that it's their choice. Works every time. Number one, when you want to make someone favor you, try to subtly mimic their movements and posture in a conversation. It creates a false sense of familiarity if you can do it right, but you have to be careful not to get caught doing it on purpose. Number two, in an argument, avoid shouting or raising your voice. Yes, your opponent might not hear you and end up speaking over you, but if you continue arguing your point in a calm, quieter manner, they'll have to stop and actually listen if they want to counter you without looking like a fool. Thus, they have to pay more attention to what you're saying. This means that not only will they become easier to persuade, but if there are any spectators, they will note you as seeming more sure of yourself and more likely to back your side as a result. If you nod while asking a question, people are more likely to say yes. I particularly use this in the restaurant selling drinks. They ask for a beer, I say, a tall one? While nodding. About 30% higher success rate than if I weren't nodding. Not sure if it's psychology, but once while at a restaurant, I tricked my dad's brain into thinking it had already sneezed. He was making those inward breaths that you do just before a sneeze. I made a sneezing sound and his brain was like, well, that's done then, and just sort of relaxed. This resulted in a completely uncontrolled sneeze with snot all over the table. He was so shocked, everyone turned around from their meals to see the aftermath of his head explosion. There was this one lady that completely manipulated her children by telling them about sugar bugs that are super tiny that can't be seen. Told her kids just scratch your teeth and see. They scratch their teeth, a bit of plaque is on their fingernail. See? I told you, sugar bug poop. They screamed and immediately started brushing their teeth. When playing rock, paper, scissors, stop right before and ask, without looking, can you tell me what color your shirt is? And people seem to always pick scissors after. I've done it to maybe 20 people and got the same result every time. while in a conversation with somebody, stare directly at the top of their head, and they will wonder if there is something in their hair or not. Thanks for watching. Subscribe.